So, very welcome to this session about Braille and mathematics. As you all know, we are very strict on time, so I will not give an introduction. I will just tell everybody who is presenting, and they will present themselves after each presentation. If they stop early enough, there will be some time for questions. So not at the end, but after each presentation. And Oliv Klingenberg, who will be the first speaker, yes, okay, together with Ole Erik Jevne, they have some handouts. So if there is anybody, a Braille reader or a large print reader who doesn't have a handout, I see some hands, then the room hosts, if they have some, yeah, have some left, they will bring. Okay, I will not take any of your time, Oliv and Ole. You will be talking about linking mobility and mathematics, learning about location through concepts in mobility and mathematics. We all are very curious. Thank you.
Thank you. Leave that.
Can you hear me? Yeah? Mm-hmm. And you?
My mic is also on? Mm-hmm. Yes, good.
As we have some more Braille handouts, I think, yeah? Yeah, we can, yeah. Then we start. Assume you are going to instruct a pupil who is blind to navigate between classrooms. Do you think he or she, while moving through the environment, construct a mental representation of the scene as a kind of paths and trails concept between guidelines and landmarks?
We have a 1 minute animation of a teacher-directed instruction.
Stand with your back against the door. Follow the wall on your left-hand side to the corner. Cross the corridor to the wall on the opposite side. Turn 90 degrees to the right. Follow the wall on your left-hand side and walk to the open door. Turn 90 degrees to the left. Take perpendicular direction with your feet on the doorstep. Cross the room till you reach the chair at the table.
You have heard the instructions. In the beginning, the animation showed nothing but the footprints from a traveler who follows the instructions. In the end, the path of these footsteps is drawn into a map of a corridor. See page 2 in your handout.
We have not studied this specific issue as in a research design, but we will present some reflections from an educational experiment conducted as an orientation and mobility / mathematics course for pupils who read Braille.
The Norwegian educational system directs wholly towards inclusive education, and thus there are no special schools for pupils with visual impairments. However, Statped, which is a state agency that offers special education services within the educational sector, invites pupils with visual impairments to attend 4-day courses at one of the Statped centers.
The themes in such courses vary and can include literacy, activity in daily living, and as in our course presented here, we had 7 hours orientation and mobility in connection with mathematics. The two other teams in our course were computer technology and physical education.
5 pupils and their teachers took part in our course. All 5 pupils are Braille readers in grade 6 or 7. 1 pupil is blind, 2 has light perception, and 2 has some vision for orientation. We planned the activities in a way that they were going to offer an increased level of difficulty using individual teaching, working in pair and group lessons. In the group lessons, we used the strategy think, pair, share. The teachers from the pupils' home schools helped us to fill in the observation forms.
First, we instructed the pupils one at a time, an indoor mobility route, sequence by sequence, as in the animation. Then, the pupils should memorize the instructions and walk the route twice. In the end of this one-to-one teaching sequence, we asked the pupils to draw the mobility route using erased line, a drawing kit.
All 5 pupils illustrated the route as a line.
Look at page 3 in the handout.
The lines started with the first instruction, and they all drew the line in a direction ahead of their body. 4 of the pupils illustrated the 90-degree turns as changes in direction. Anne and Betty have made these 2 drawings from corridor A. Anne is blind in her right eye and has severely reduced vision in her left eye. Her sight is useful for orientation. Betty is congenitally blind with light perception only.
This is Edward's drawing.
Page 4 in the handout.
Edward has no perception of light and he is blind from birth. Even though Edward has marked the corners as landmark, he has drawn the mobility route as a straight line.
Edward explained to Betty, "This is the picture." This was a picture he discovered and touched while he moved through the corridor. He illustrated the picture as a vertical line.
We observed that Edward was less free to get around in the classroom and the corridors. He was less free than the other pupils were. He was a passive passenger, wanting to hold the arm of another adult or a pupil.
We also observed that he often moved in a sideways position and touched the wall with both hands.
Discussion between pupils is central in a learning process, and therefore we ask them to explain their drawings to each other. In this way, they could reason about direction, distances, and locations. We wanted them to build up a repertoire of situation and to use geometric concept, and we wanted them to use their own words.
When Edward heard Betty's explanation and looked at her tactile drawing, he, although he wasn't at the city hall yesterday evening, he exclaimed, "Wow! You have drawn the corners." Because of this acknowledgement, we let Edward walk the mobility route another 2 times. And the instructor tried to focus particularly on the direction changes. Then Edward made a new drawing, which was nearly a copy of the first one. He continued to illustrate the mobility route as a straight line.
We would like to make comments on this later. But first, we will present some of the other activities we had prepared for this course.
The educational idea in the course was to let pupils associate their bodily experiences in orientation and mobility and relate this knowledge to more abstract mathematical concepts about coordinate systems. We agree about this statement. Relating the new topic to previous learning allow pupils to feel ownership of the new information. Thus, before introducing a mathematical coordinate system, we ask the pupils to read a map of the corridor.
The same map as in page 2 in the handout.
The next step was to put needles where they started, where they ended, and otherwise all the places where they change direction.
The pupils worked in pairs and explained to each other. We have a picture here of 20 fingers on a map, illustrating this teamwork. And unlucky, we did not record the explanations.
To help the pupils understand coordinates, we played the sinking battleship game, which is a guessing game for two players. Oliv will show the game now. In our course, we practiced it for teams of two pupils played together. It is played on a grid paper on which players' ships are marked with needles. The location of the ships are hidden from the other players. Players alternate turns calling shots at the other players' ships, and the objective of the game is to destroy the opposing players' fleet.
Games may have an important effect to improve problem-solving skills, allowing learners to try new strategies, stimulating logical reasoning, etc. Furthermore, when a child experiences something fun, it's likely that he or she repeats these procedures and skills.
We wanted the pupils to repeat how to find and read the coordinates of the squares in the 2-centimeter grid paper, such as B5 and D4. The game was an activity parallel to the mobility instruction, and because it became popular, the pupils continued to play it in the breaks. Our experience is that sinking battleship is well suited to help pupils understand a coordinate system. Similar to the grid paper in sinking battleships, we can also make a grid on the corridor map.
To illustrate this, the pupils put a concrete grid. You have one here, Ole Erik?
It was close.
A concrete grid as a network on top of their corridor map. This was an introduction to corridor maps with coordinates. And this is page 5 in your handout. The fifth. We don't have page numbers on the handout, but the fifth. Yeah. We asked the pupils to specify the coordinates on the starting point, the end, and the turns in their mobility route. You have a map, Ole Erik?
Yeah.
Yeah.
If I use the map with the coordinates and find the starting point where I started my mobility route, it is C1 on the map, in square C1.
Assorted grid and dot papers provide an alternative to geoboards, and different types of papers changes the activities and provides new opportunity for insight and discovery, as, for example, the differences of spaces and intersections in a grid paper. Throughout the course, we also introduce sheets with raised dots instead of grids, and we presented 4 quadrants with the use of negative number.
That is on page 6 in the handout.
Ole-Erik, can you find the coordinates of the plastic dot?
I am the clever one. It is 4, 3.
Okay, then I want you to put point N76. Clever. And in 10, 3. Suppose you draw lines between these points. What kind of a shape have you formed?
It is a triangle.
Very good. But this was a different task, especially for Edward. He couldn't do it. Summary.
The course has provided us with some understanding, but also new ideas and questions of how to help pupils with visual impairments to grasp concepts of coordinate systems, as well as how to stimulate a feel for the geometric aspects of the surroundings.
One hypothesis when preparing the activities is that bodily experience and awareness of how to change position in space influence comprehension of spatial concepts. Observing the pupils in the course activities has made this assumption stronger.
Linking the two subjects can be a successful approach, not least for the teachers in mathematics, because it brings new perspectives in how to do mathematics. An important question thus is how to link these subjects in mainstream school.
Ole Erik and I, together with Magnar Stoleløkken, we have also discussed the potential of using coordinate systems to create another activities that focus the changing relationships between the individual and the surrounding objects. For example, to discuss what happens when you move from square B4 and to square C3. What kind of a direction do you have then? What is behind you? What do you have in front of you?
We observed that Anne and one of the boys, who both have some visual function, were less efficient in their haptic exploratory procedures. Their fingers did not adhere to any systematic method that would determine a reference point around which they organized their exploration strategies. We wonder, is this a random observation?
Maybe not. Edward remarked the corners in Betty's drawing, but was he focusing the way she had made them, or did he just repeat what she had said? We cannot be sure because we do not have video recordings.
We observed that Edward often walked sideways and touched the wall with both hands. This is a person-centered position, and in this position the wall will continuously be in front of his body, also when he has turned around the corner.
Maybe that is because the line was straight. It's always from his body. So he had drawn a straight line.
We think that Edward is not aware of his body position, which can be seen in many pupils with congenital blindness and in pupils with low muscle tone. Edward needed much help to participate in many of the more abstract activities. His behavior and focus in lessons differed from the others. He talked and asked about many things, everything and nothing.
Spatial concepts influence our language, as they are vital in both mobility and orientation and in geometric thinking. Everyone possesses a level of spatial orientation along a continuum from concrete, person-centered knowledge to a more abstract understanding of space. We wonder, in what way do teachers consider the function in orientation and mobility when preparing tasks in mathematics?
Without geometric experiences, most people do not grow in their spatial sense or spatial reasoning. The goal is to sequence activities from simple to complex and concrete to abstract in order to provide scaffolding and to challenge the individual to improve his current skill level.
We have shared some reflections from an educational experiment linking orientation and mobility / mathematics. There is a need for replications in order to determine whether our experiences can be considered meaningful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this very clear presentation.